In the next 90 minutes, we're going to just try to listen to some people from different perspectives about what it's like to be a Christian around the world in different places and how that plays itself out. I almost don't want to introduce myself. I'm Brad Strait, the iron-fisted warlord. If you get a chance to know me, you know I'm much more like the iron-fisted teddy bear. The real issue, I just want to confess something to you. I am the one that invited Ed Stetzer to be a part of this, and it's my own fault that he slammed me so much. So I have to own that. Didn't Ed, how many of you were in here for Ed? Many of you, didn't he do a great job? I've had the privilege of listening to Ed many, many times, and he's always really good at just taking a really complex situation and making it understandable, and talking about both the headwinds that we face as Christians, and then maybe the opportunities, the tailwinds that we have, and I'm very thankful for his ability to do that. And so what we're supposed to do today is to try to figure out, so what do we learn? It's really easy to be motivated or to say, I get it, I understand, but there's emotion that needs to take place in our hearts where we say, Lord, what are you teaching me? Because it's the inside truth that is really going to set us free. You know, you can read a lot of papers from a lot of really smart people and feel like you get it, but it's only when the Lord speaks to you inside that you really say, okay, I know what I'm supposed to do. So let's pray. It's hard for us to focus, Lord, sometimes. And we live in a world that is frayed and being pulled apart in a lot of ways. And so we would ask that you would come and you would be our shalom, that we might breathe deeply the Ruah Elohim, the breath of God, into our hearts. And that as we talk about a world, not just a nation, but a world that is really going through all sorts of changes, Lord, would you help us to figure out what it is you want us to do? And may we understand it clearly enough, even as poor receivers of your perfection, that we know the next step, the next way. Thank you for each of my panelists. I thank you for all that has fit together to make them be able to be here with us. Would you bless this time? In your name, amen. So the panel looks different than I expected it to. We have a Cambodian pastor who is in the hospital with some respiratory disease. We don't think it's COVID, but Satan Lee, Lord Jesus, bless him with health. He was supposed to be sitting here, and he has an amazing story too. So there's that. And then we have a pastor who served in Peru, who got a call from the Peruvian White House, who said, can you fly down? We'd like to meet with you because we've got an issue we need to solve. So several of these folks I added in, and they're all looking at me with glassy eyes like, we have no idea what you're going to do. And that's okay. I trust the Lord. Would you take a second and why don't you start, Erick, and introduce yourself as kind of tell us your context of world Christianity.
Okay, my name is Erick Schenkel, and I think in the whole issue of persecution, the very first experience I had that's relevant is about 3 months after I met Jesus in Northern Kentucky through my high school math teacher, I went away to Harvard College. And whereas I don't think I experienced what I would call persecution there, I certainly experienced opposition. And I actually stayed at Harvard, did 4 degrees there. And my experience there was such that I've never expected to be a Christian in an atmosphere where people agreed with me. I've always expected that I would be opposed in my context. But then after pastoring in the U.S. for about 22 years, my wife and I were called to Central Asia. We had a heart for the Muslim world. About 4 years into our time in Central Asia, we were attacked by men in black ski masks and running suits with hatchets. They beat us with the sides and back of the hatchets. Nearly killed my wife. Hurt me bad enough. This was at 4 a.m. in our home. And it took us a while to recover. God called us back to Tashkent. We're able to be there 10 years total. When we went back, we began to go in and out of Afghanistan as we pushed the Taliban south, our troops pushed the Taliban south. We were able to take teams in Afghanistan and saw a whole different level of persecution there. We saw lots of local folks suffer in both Uzbekistan and Afghanistan, which I can talk about as we go along. Then I was area campus crusade director for the strategy for the Muslim world for some years, traveling around the Middle East and North Africa, saw lots there, and then had the privilege of leading the Jesus Film Ministry for 6 years, and was able to drop in on a few tough spots that I hadn't hit during our years in the Middle East. So had a lot of opportunity to think about this issue of hardship for Christians.
So I want to continue around and introduce it, but I think you brought up a great starting point here, is that it's a spectrum, and maybe at one end it's opposition, and at the other end it's imprisonment and death, and so it happens not just at one place. And so it's hard for me to say as Americans we're persecuted, honestly, because we're still pretty free, but it's not hard for me to believe that the spectrum is shifting and moving. And so we're going to talk about it all along that line. Andrew, you probably don't need an introduction, but why don't you tell us kind of your story?
Yes, my wife and I were in Turkey 25 years. The last two of those I was in prison. Many of you prayed for me, for which I'm very grateful. And when I think of persecution for the state, since I've been talking about this for some time, I don't know that it's going to involve prison for many people. I don't think we're looking at China or North Korea levels. But I also, I do believe it's coming, and I'd suggest a Pascal's wager, for those of you who've heard of that, is if you prepare for persecution and it doesn't come, you're still going to be okay. But if you don't prepare for persecution and it does come, then it can really knock you out. It's much more difficult than people think, and maybe I'm jumping ahead of myself here. Brad nods, yes, you're jumping ahead. So, but I do want to say, I think even if we're talking about persecution, I think we're going to have social and financial pressure. As I said, we're not talking about Chinese level or North Korea level. But it can, that is enough. That is enough to knock a lot of people out. And I think one of the things is that we underestimate how difficult persecution can be. I did. If someone had told me before, and feel free to stop me whenever you want. If someone
it
had told me,
it never works.
What?
It never works.
Okay. If someone had told me that I was going to spend time in Turkish prison, I would have been afraid. But I also honestly would have had a sense of bravado. Bring it on! I can do this. A lot of my heroes have suffered, so bring it on! It's going to be good. I'll make it through. And it was a lot more difficult than I thought. People often. I've heard people, when we talk about persecutions, have that same attitude or say very optimistically or positively, this is going to be good for the church, it'll be good for us, it'll make us strong, so let it come, look at China. And yes, the church did grow in China. Persecution always grows the church. I'd say, yes, that's true, except when it isn't true. And sometimes it doesn't happen that way. I'll give you one example. I met with a Chinese leader. He was one of the most wanted men in China. Was on the run for many years, but also in prison multiple times. He remained faithful. His wife divorced him and left the faith. So same persecution, two very different responses. And so I would say, let us not underestimate how difficult it can be to stand under pressure. Even if that pressure is just that of shaming, of being ostracized, of being misunderstood and called evil, that's enough to turn many people away. So even if we don't get up to very intense levels of persecution, the lower levels are also enough to knock a lot of people out unless they're very grounded and they're willing to pay a price. And some of those things that we consider less, so you lose your job because you speak for truth or you don't celebrate things that are sin. Well, that can sound very glorious, but, and it is, and it will be highly rewarded by the Lord in heaven, and that's what really, really counts. But here you may pay a price for the rest of your life, and your loved ones may also pay a price for it. So I don't think we should minimize even lower levels of, and I don't think we're seeing a lot of persecution here. My warning isn't, guys, we're being persecuted, aren't you aware? No, it's coming. There is that wave coming. And I wasn't here this morning, so I don't know what Ed said. But I want to reiterate that there's a message specifically to the EPC through this, what God has spoken to Brad and has shown there. We are supposed to prepare. We need to prepare. And because there is a wave coming, there's a timing to this. Is coming soon, and God has given us strategy specifically on how to do this.
So I have the benefit of believing exactly what you just said, but also having watched the videos 20 or 30 times each as I was working on the study guide, I get Andrew in a way that not everybody does. And Andrew is not trying to engage us politically to one side or another. He's not trying to create fear in people. He's got a pastor's heart who just lived through it and recognized how hard it was for him to be in prison and to break, that it motivates him to want to say, wake up, pay attention, stand guard, watch out. And I to the very core of my being, believe that is a great and timely warning. So thanks for that. Sam Searcy. Samuel, tell us a little bit about your context for ministry and kind of what you've experienced.
Thank you. I see myself as one who has had the least experience dealing with persecution. I've always read about that in the Bible and had stories about that. I have not experienced it directly, but I'm coming from Sierra Leone, which is 78% Muslim in West Africa, and I've had the privilege of serving in ministry in Sierra Leone, Guinea, Liberia, Nigeria, and Ghana. And I know many Christians in some of those places who are facing persecution. I feel like I can bring the context of secret persecution in cultures where there is huge attempts by the government to try and promote unity or religious tolerance. So we don't have that open, widespread persecution, but I have many stories I think I could share of many of the Lord's people who have been going through secret persecution. I have to say that I've been in ministry for a number of years now, and one of those moments where I was really afraid for my faith was really just praying for Andrew when he was in Turkey. And you would think that that's just a simple thing to do, but I was able to mobilize many people, including leaders of the church in Sierra Leone, to pray. And I remember posting a couple of times on Facebook, and somebody said to me, I might get in trouble with the Turkish government because of my association with him. In Nigeria, I think that was the most obvious one. I had to travel to northern Nigeria on ministry with an armed man in the vehicle. And it just hit me that, okay, this is it. This is what many of my brothers and sisters all over the world are facing. And throughout the course of that journey, we expected that anything could happen to us. But praise God, my greatest, I say it's my greatest regret in ministry with regards to persecution was when I went to look out for a 16-year-old girl who had become a Christian from the Kuranko tribe, one of the most unreached people's group in West Africa, and was doing well, and her parents were persecuting her, and she ran away. Then the parents turned the conversation to discrediting the church, the body of Christ. This is just a small group of us coming to this Kuranko community and trying to plant a church there. And all of a sudden, I thought the name of the Lord was being discredited because they were saying that the Christians had run away with this 16-year-old girl. And in order to try and defend the name of the Lord and the church, I sent people out to look for this girl. And the minute I brought her, she was given in marriage, and she's never come back to church. So I thought, I've seen her a couple of times, she's not great. And I thought I was responsible for that. So again, I don't feel I have too much to share. I have several of such stories of secret persecution in a country that promotes religious tolerance. And I'll be happy to share my perspective on that. Thank you.
Thank you, Samuel. We've had several of our EPC pastors go with Samuel to Sierra Leone and do ministry, and have seen amazing converts, even in situations that didn't seem easy. So I'm very thankful for you. Ken Chang is one of my intellectual brothers. He has the biggest brain of anybody I know, and doesn't have an ego that matches it. He's a very humble man. But Ken, tell us a little bit about kind of what you do and how you have experienced the church.
I feel a little bit like the relief goalie in an NHL game, you know, the guy that sits there in the locker room waiting to come on. No, So I'm an elder at Cherry Creek Presbyterian Church. Unlike these three servants of God, four servants of God up here, I'm a lay leader. I'm an attorney at law. And the focus of my practice has actually been in China for the last 20 years, and including living there for about 5 years, coming back pre-COVID. And so my practice and what I do for a living necessitates that I interact with a lot of different aspects of Chinese society, including the government, including the diplomatic corps, and fortunately for me, including the vibrant church that exists in China as well, where I served as a lay leader at a church in Shanghai for several years and preached and ministered and did that type of work over in China. So it's the perspective that I hope to bring here is kind of an understanding of, you know, what is persecution and the lenses by which we look at persecution. I like to call it persecution with Chinese characteristics because it's not uniform and it's not the same. And in some ways it's incredibly violent and horrible. And in other ways it's incredibly passive. It may be showing one up one day at church and the police are there and they say, no church today. And you're like, huh? And they're, yep, gates closed. And you go back home. And so we would, in the United States, with the filter of religious freedom that we have in this country that was mentioned before, say, that's awful, that's horrible, that can't happen. To us, it's a Sunday. And you turn around and then you try again the next Sunday. to go, and you usually can get in. So it's an interesting case study in persecution, because it is so varied and so inconsistent, and yet it's the largest country in the world, and it shows models for us to follow. As Andrew's mentioning, when waves start coming, how do we react, and how should we behave, and what things we can do to remain faithful and propagate the church.
Amen. So I shared yesterday that the Lord got my attention about persecution in whatever way he chose to do it, and it made me very interested in, so what's happening around the world? So I started almost 20 years ago not only studying persecution and reading about persecution and talking to people who came from persecuted places, but actually going to places and spending time with underground churches. And so I've been to China several times where I've been taken to the underground church. I've attended public churches too, where you have to stand in line for 2 hours to get a seat inside this public church in Beijing. But I've also spent time with house church leaders in China. And I've been to India several times and taught pastors where all of their name tags have the same name on them, printed out so that there's a level of anonymity, because the persecution is so great. And I've been to back rooms and homes where almost all of the pastors who are sitting around are scarred in one way or another. Many of them wear what they call the collar of Christ, which is a rope burn around their neck from where they have been dragged behind a vehicle. As kind of a lesson to the rest of their church as to what might happen. And then I've been to places in Africa where people have actually given their lives because they're so committed. So that doesn't make me an expert of anything, but it does mean that I've had a hunger to learn. And our hope is just to share maybe a little bit of what we've learned and equip each other. It can be a very somber thing, and I'll be really honest, if I can just be frank, it's kind of my way, but this whole being up in front and talking about my dreams and talking about persecution, and somehow maybe I'm going to get assigned to some right-wing side or some left-wing side or some angry side, that's not me. I'm a bridge builder. I'm a lover, and as we were approaching this, I had moments where I thought, I don't know that I want to teach this, and I don't know, I get how a pastor would say, I don't want to talk about persecution in my church. It's going to be divisive. We got people on every side. It's going to make them fearful, and I felt all of those things, honestly. But you have to do what the Lord calls you to do, and. About a month ago, I shared publicly with my church my dreams and preached on persecution. And an odd thing happened. They stood and applauded. Now, it's not because I'm such a spectacular communicator. It's because it touched a core of truth in them. And so that's my hope in all of this. And so I know some of you pastors out there are thinking, I don't want to talk about persecution. We have enough issues just trying to figure out, when are we done with COVID and how do I get the choir to stop complaining? You know, we're still trying to figure out, you know, how many times are we going to take communion this month? And are we gonna dip or break or use them horrible little, how many of you guys are still using those horrible little zipper cups? Oh, Lord. I have to tell you, I just have a hard time imagining Jesus going, this is my body. And usually you spill something. And so I'm just afraid that we get overwhelmed with, we just have too much on our plate just right now, that we miss that maybe the Lord has a warning for us that we can learn from these people. So let me ask you, how did the persecution, the struggle, the oppression in the places that you've seen. How did it affect Christians? How did it affect the Christians that were there? Anybody want to start?
I'll start. Yeah, I think it drove them to the scripture. I think that when you encounter what the Word of God says, what the New Testament says about persecution, we quickly realize that persecution is the normal Christian life. That we in America have lived in this window of exception in all of Christian history. And so we're not always the best people when we go cross-culturally as missionaries to help people understand what it means to follow Jesus. So they find it on their own. I remember being in a meeting with some of our local believers in Uzbekistan, and this happened to be a meeting of student leaders. I worked both with student leaders and with village leaders showing the Jesus film. And we were trying to deal with the fact that they knew there were informers being placed by the government in their circles. I think persecution can come from three kinds of sources: the government, the general culture, and then these radical groups within the culture that are not the majority culture but can cause you some trouble. But this was government sending informers in, and they could lose their spot in university, which is hard won in that culture, post-Soviet Muslim culture. And one girl just popped up and said, well, when you read the Bible, the model is for every 12, there's one betrayer. Obvious. And so, yeah, if we had one more, we'd have a half betrayer up here. So they came to expect that for every 12 new believers that came in, one of them would have been planted by the government on average. That's the biblical model. Now, I, as a Christian, an American Christian, had never considered looking at that biblical model. You know, and the one that Brad mentioned yesterday, if you were here in Mark 13, they're going to call you before council to give witness. Don't worry about what you're going to say, because the Holy Spirit will give you in that hour what you'll say. And you'll be my witnesses before government authorities, before leaders. My Jesus film guys, they lived and breathed that. They were always getting arrested, stopped, and taken in, slapped around. And what did they do every time? Holy Spirit, what do you want me to say? And they saw that as an evangelistic method. Now, granted, the persecution they received wasn't so severe. So that, you know, when Andrew talks about this being a complex issue, I understand that. But for them, seeing that biblical model just made it natural that was the way they lived. And so I think one thing I saw with believers under persecution was that it drove them to look past, you know, my American discipleship to what the scripture said about the matter.
So I would say that in my observations and my experience, that persecution drives relationships. And what I mean by that is, in the United States, we're very focused on the programming of church and what church is, and we strive to build relationships in that context. And when your church is uncertain, when your ability to gather collectively as a large group is put into question, it drives the congregation to make individual relationships stronger. Because while you may not be able to gather as 100 or 200 or 400, you certainly can meet in a cafe and gather as two or three and get together. And so when you go to even more provinces that where you know there's more heavily persecuted people, and you visit churches and church people, you see very deep relationships that have the common experience of uncertainty and fear as to what might happen with their church, but they're sticking together like glue. And in many ways, it's aspirational for the American church that we would have those types of relationships among congregants, to where they would sacrifice and share these things with each other and meet the way that they meet.
Let me just, again, hook to that. I was invited with our missions pastor to go to a secret gathering in Canada where a minority group in China and ministers that minister to them, and I won't even use their name, were meeting secretly. And part of that process was you gave up your cell phone as you walked in because they were afraid somebody was going to be watching. But what struck me there was how much they loved each other and how much they needed each other. And the fact that they have been granted just a moment, a few days to be away and to be together and just to love on each other, it was transformative to me. And I think sometimes we take that for granted. You know, we say hi to our friends and go get our donut. And we miss how much we need each other. We have to defend this connectionalism that we have, and we miss that. Other ways you've seen Christians or the churches that you've been around affected by difficulties or persecution?
I always think that at least maybe this is what it was intended to be, that every time the church experiences persecution, the immediate outcome is fear, great fear. And in a way, persecution weakens the church at that initial moment. But as you said, that's the opportunity that we now have to come together and synergize. And that's where the church is strengthened and emboldened. And in every experience that I have learned, the church ends up becoming stronger. But we have to just be aware that when it comes, it weakens us a little bit. I can think of a situation that happened in Sierra Leone. Again, I talked about Sierra Leone being a religious tolerant country, 78% Muslim. About 14 years ago, there was a request from the Organization of Islamic Countries to have Sierra Leone become a member. And we know our roots as Sierra Leonean Christians, that this is the fountain of Christian missionary work within West Africa. The first theological seminary in West Africa was built in Sierra Leone, and missionaries were being trained in Sierra Leone and sent to Nigeria and Ghana and other places. So the church, as a church, we did not want that. But of course, that went on to happen. And what has happened is that we have this Zimbabwean Muslim scholar who comes to Sierra Leone every year. His name is Muftai Menk. And he mobilizes the Muslim population in their thousands for a crusade-like program. And shouting, Allahu Akbar. So we had a situation in 2017 in October where a pastor, actually a Nigerian pastor who has lived in Sierra Leone for over 30 years, stood up against that. And he started shouting that Sierra Leone is for Jesus. Sierra Leone is for Jesus. As my brother just said there, every 12 disciples, you would always have one betrayer there. He did not know that somebody was recording what he was saying in his church on Sunday morning. And that led to the closure of his church. The government stepped in with the idea that they wanted to protect him, and they put him in custody. What happened was great fear came upon all of us. We just know we are outnumbered, and that perhaps we may not be able to take the risk at confronting these people if we try them. We were silent for a long time, but again, as people started praying and started networking with one another and started praying, then we were able to regain our boldness, our courage, and started confronting the situation to the point of demanding the release of this pastor and the reopening of his church, which eventually happened. So again, I'm just highlighting the fact that that's the initial response. We are brought down on our knees in great fear, but that also necessitates our need for the Lord, which turns us into prayer.
So after the crucifixion, where are the 11 remaining? They are locked, hiding in the upper room, afraid of what knock might come from the government on their door. I think that fear is a normal response. But fear is not from the Lord. Fear is really from the enemy. And the whole proposition of Andrew's videos is that there are skill sets that we can develop that help us move past the fear quickly and be ready. And I remember one thing that you said, we have to decide, are we going to fear the Lord more than we fear men? And I have said that in my head 100 times. Do we really fear the Lord? Andrew, you want to comment on any of that?
First of all, Norine says that she's an ostrich. By her own admission, she doesn't want to think about things that will make her afraid. She prefers not to think about it. But the wave is coming, is going to hit us, and I don't want to make people afraid, but at the same time, there is a healthy side to fear, which is that it's meant to trigger an appropriate response in us. And when there is a threat, we have that adrenaline rush, or we have that fear. It's meant for us to do something about it. And so it's not inappropriate to have some concern about the pressure that's coming, but it's meant to trigger a proper response in us, that we be sober-minded. One of the things I want to emphasize is to that we talk about the difficulties that people face about persecution so that we begin to develop a different mentality. In Turkey, if someone is going to become a believer, they know that there's going to be some pressure from their family, from their social circle. They're going to pay a price in some way. And so it's already baked in, you know, when they make their decision. Whereas we've been a majority Christian culture, at least as culturally, we've had that that positive view of Christianity in the past. And so we're going to have to learn to think more as a minority. One of the things that comes when you're a minority is you don't have a lot of political influence. So that will be one of the differences. And one of the concerns is some people don't want to talk about these issues because they will be accused of being political. I have friends, EPC pastors, outside of the EPC as well, but I think especially some EPC friends who have, obviously, many times we don't have to talk about the excesses on the left. They're very clear, very visible, but there are also excesses on the right. There's some, you could almost say, a wokeness on the left, but there's a wokeness on the right that is very toxic and destructive to churches, and a lot of pastors have felt pulled, lobbied in their churches, that they have to take sides and maybe more distinct sides than they need to. And there's a concern if we bring up some of these issues, we talk about persecution, and the reason for persecution is the wedge issues. I think I mentioned the exclusivity of Jesus and salvation, but also his demands for obedience in a number of these hotly contested areas in our culture. So if you bring up those issues, you can be seen as political. Often those who are pushing, for example, LGBT issues or gender ideology or abortion, CRT, any number of these things, when they talk about it, it's just a matter of justice, love, morality. But if a Christian talks about it, immediately they're going to be accused of being political. So that's almost inevitable. That's the way that these things will be viewed. But I don't think these issues are primarily political. I think of Joshua. You all know the story of Joshua. They've just crossed the Jordan, and they're across from Jericho. And then this man appears before him with a sword, and Joshua says, "Whose side are you on? Are you on our side or with our enemies?" And he says, "No, I'm the commander of the Lord's armies. I'm not on your side. I'm not on their side. We have a different side. It's God's side." And so God does have a side. He's not Republican, he's not Democrat, he's way too big for that. He has his own side. And we have to make sure we're getting on his side. And he has an opinion on many of these issues. And so I have to say about everything, whatever God says about it, whatever he says about himself, whatever he says about me, whatever he says about others. If he says something is sin, I have to say it is sin. And if he says it's good, I have to say it's good. So when we talk about some of these issues, as long as we're saying what God says about it, it's not political. It's a matter of being faithful to his word, being faithful to him. And so I, for those who think if I bring up some of these subjects, we have to teach our church. People are getting very, very confused. Our younger generation is very confused. And I think some pastors are holding back from addressing these issues and preparing their people because they don't want to be seen as political. So don't be political. Be faithful to the word.
I actually listened to all eight of the tapes that Andrew and Norine made last night because I wanted to understand what Andrew was saying about persecution, and I can highly recommend them to you. What he says about nearness to God, eternal perspective, the fear of God overcoming the fear of persecution and other things, and spiritual disciplines that God led him into to strengthen him, not being offended when trouble comes. There's solid gold in those sessions. And as I was reflecting on some of this, I think I realized one thing. Andrew's speaking pastorally, as Brad said, and I think prophetically in this series. I think evangelistically. It's just a difference in calling and perspective. And one of the things that I realized became mine when I was in the Muslim world watching people suffer for their faith is that I realized it was okay to be in a culture where non-Christian values ruled the day. You could still enjoy life, you could still enjoy Jesus, you still had one another. You had the Word of God, you had the Holy Spirit, you had what you needed. And so when I think about preparing for persecution, one of the things I feel is the reason I'm not a culture warrior is I don't have anything to defend. Jesus didn't defend a lot of things. He was always on the offensive with love, with care, with proclamation. And so it was okay that the culture around the early church was opposed to them. What did they do about the fact that the Word of God contradicted much of what the culture was saying? They lived the Word of God. And by living the Word of God, they showed the culture around them that there was a better way. And so one of the models for me through the years has become the model of Elijah on Mount Carmel. The way that Elijah dealt with this non-Christian culture around him was, he said, okay, we'll build two altars. I'll build an altar to the living God, you build an altar to your God, and we'll see where the fire falls. So they build their altar and cry out and cut themselves and do all the kinds of things that they did to try to get fire to fall on the altar. Nothing happens. Then Elijah says, pour some water on my altar. Go ahead. Go ahead, pour water on it. It's not going to hurt it. And the fire of God falls on the altar of Elijah. And so the picture there is simply building our own altar by living the Word of God and demonstrating to the culture where we live that there's a better way, that God's way is a better way. Now, I think one of the things that our culture is afraid of us about is they think we're about imposing the way of God. And one of my observations through the years about the difference between what God commands us to do in Scripture, in other words, what we do as Christians, and what Muslims do, because we believe a lot of the same things. We believe God has a way, He has a law. We believe He's going to be judge. And we believe that He'll judge those who break His ways. But as Muslims, they believe that they ought to implement that now. That God's law ought to be put in place by the force of arms or the force of government. And some of what they put in place isn't half bad. I'd rather go to a Muslim beach than an American beach. If I go to an American beach, it's a full day of fighting temptation. If I go to a Muslim beach, the women don't dress that way. So it's not a bad thing, but they put that in place by force of law. But we believe that God isn't judging yet. That what He said is, He's slow concerning His promise to return, not wanting anyone to perish under judgment, but to give time for all to come to repentance. And so we live in an age of proclaiming the good news that Jesus came to save us, that times in between His first coming and His second coming for us is a precious time of declaring to people that they can be forgiven and come into right relationship with God. So as an evangelist, I don't feel like I need to impose God's ways on my culture. I feel like I can live God's ways as an alternative, and the fire will fall on the church. In other words, the holy fire, the approval of God, the thing that makes everybody stand up and say, yeah, that's a better way to live. And you can do that anywhere. We could do that when there were only a few hundred of us in a country of 35 million. So, you know, persecution, yeah. You know, I believe it's coming. And I believe that we can remain offensive in the good sense of the word, not offensive, but we can remain actively and very aggressively preaching the good news of Jesus' love, regardless of what happens in the culture.
I remember one of the pastors in India, me asking him, how do you share your faith? And he said, well, mostly I pray. And then I pray some more, and then I pray, and then during the day the Lord will bring me someone, and He says, now, and I talk. And he said, that has become all I really need to do. And in the pressure of having to be underground as a church, the Lord kept opening door after door after door, and they'd say, pretty soon we have too many people in our little hidden church to be hidden anymore. So somebody else has to go and lead. Who does anybody have a Bible? Does anybody? Okay, you're now the pastor. Go. You take these four. They're now yours. And sometimes we have such a small view of God. We undersell how gracious and merciful and good and powerful God is to do His work. We feel like we got to get it all figured out. We got to vote right or change right or fix right, and then the Lord will really do His stuff. And my brothers and sisters, that's idolatry. The Lord doesn't need us. He is sufficient. He uses us because He wants us to be a part, and He loves us, so He wants us to participate in what He's doing. But He is capable of doing a lot of things. Ken or Samuel, any thoughts?
To take on a little bit of what Eric was saying there, to me, at its base, persecution is a spiritual battle. And so to try and get down into the mud on the things that are issued from princes and principalities is not just a losing game for the church, actually, I think, but it's also a waste of time and energy for the church. And so right now, my perception is that at least a part of the church has pushed a lot of chips in on doing that and to put a lot of resources into trying to win that game instead of focusing in on the spiritual aspect of this, okay, which is, as Eric was saying, to love Jesus and to spread the good news. In China, you see this dichotomy between the established church and what is the underground or home church. The established church, both Catholics and Protestants in the two main sectors, comprise somewhere between 50 to 60 million Christians who have acquiesced to government authority, who have minders and cameras and rules and regulations. And that was a church I attended. But I can also tell you that the church I attended loved Jesus, proclaimed Jesus, evangelized Jesus, and you would not be able to distinguish it, and Eric's been to this church, would not be able to distinguish it probably from a lot of congregations in the United States. On the other hand, we have the persecuted church in China, the underground church of the home churches, who have not acquiesced and are evangelizing and growing as well. You see two different models, and this is why China's crazy. You see two different models, okay, of really trying to figure out how to serve the Lord. And both are instructive, I think, to us, okay? That there are times where you're going to take that stand and you're going to be driven underground and do those things. And there are times where acquiescence and surrender isn't necessarily a bad thing because you can advance the kingdom of God in what you're doing, okay? As long as you're able to proclaim the gospel as it is. So it's kind of an interesting model to look at because you see a lot of different things going on. But at the end of the day, it's not about the fight that we put up against those things that are terrestrial. It's the spiritual warfare and the surrender to Jesus and letting him guide us through our ministries that allow the church to grow and thrive.
Yeah, I think one of the biggest takeaways here is just that reality that persecution, as you said, it should be for the normal Christian. And if we have not experienced it now, it's only because of God's grace and mercy. It doesn't mean that we may never experience it. And of course, there are different forms of that. I remember in Sierra Leone, we were just on a conference talking about missions and evangelism and just looking at the promises of God. We always say that that great scripture in Matthew 24, this gospel of the kingdom has to be preached before Christ comes. And someone pointed to us in Revelation chapter 6 earlier on, there was the opening of the seals, and here in the fifth seal in verse 9, the fifth seal was open, and under the altar was the souls of those who had been slain because of the word of God and the testimony they maintained. And they were calling out with a loud voice, "How long, sovereign Lord, holy and true, until you judge the inhabitants of the earth and avenge our blood?" What response did we get? Then each of them was given a white robe, and they were told to wait a little longer until the number of their fellow servants and brothers who were to be killed as they were was completed. So it's only a matter of time. You can almost say it's prophetic. It's the way the Lord accelerates the growth of the church. We say that the seed of the martyrs, the blood of the martyrs was the seed of the church. Somebody said that great quote many years ago. So if we are not experiencing it yet, we should expect it, as Andrew is saying, and it could come in different forms. It's very important to understand, as a church leader, where it might be coming from. What are the likely ways? So for us in Sierra Leone, there is African traditional religion. There are Muslims. They are in the majority. And I think for us, if we're going to be persecuted by these people, it's because they see us as infidels. They want us to be holy and righteous. They want us to follow their faith and their religion, almost like wanting us to go to heaven, to have a relationship with God. They see that our way is not right. And maybe they're willing to pay the price to get us to that point. In 2016, there was a young Sierra Leonean man called Ibrahim Kanu. He was on an Air France plane in Freetown with petrol and matches with the goal of trying to bomb himself. That would have been perhaps the first that a Sierra Leonean was becoming a suicide bomber. But some of us came back together while the government was investigating and said, we have to do something to engage the Muslim people that our Muslim brothers and sisters are not radicalized. Because once they get to that point, they will do anything. Sometimes I think it's different from the US because most of the people that persecute you are not necessarily giving you any hope of eternal life or wanting you to make heaven with them. And that's what our people think back home. They think that we've strayed away from the true ways and they consider us infidels and reach out to us. Again, I would just emphasize the need to understand where it might be coming from and to be prepared for that. To be prepared for that, yeah.
I need to burnish my evangelism credentials just a little. Notice, we were involved in church planting in Turkey. We were involved in a number of church plants, and this is what really drove me there. I wanted to see the church grow, expand. And right now I'm speaking more, I need to say that so that then I can speak more pastorally, which is a focus on the church. When people became believers in Turkey, you know, it's a very small minority. There are what, maybe 7,000 believers from a Turkish background out of 85 million people. So it's a very small church. They're not going to, when they come into the church, we don't say, we want you to now go out and speak out against all the evils in your culture and speak out against the immorality you see and the corruption and against government. We don't say that because what we really want is for them to just become healthy followers of Jesus, to be devoted to him. And now as I speak about the church and I speak to you, I'm encouraging you to focus on the church and not on evangelism. Evangelism is always something we need to do. This is a time especially, I think, to focus on strengthening the foundations. And I think there's a time for that because we need to stand in difficult times. We need to be able to survive the wave so that we can do the work of evangelism. And I think if we have a healthy church, if we're focused on Jesus, I wanted to read something that my friend Rod Dreher wrote. He said, I think it's true that on both left and right, churches that focus so intensely on what's happening now, whether looking at it from the left or the right, are going to fail. And I think we need to be focused on the one. I read a lot about what's happening now. Yesterday, that's what I was talking about. What are, you know, the signs of what is coming. But if we focus on the health of our church, on devotion to Jesus, on preparing our hearts, that is what will make us attractive and a light in the darkness. So I think this is a time especially to focus on, when I encourage you to speak the truth about a lot of these difficult issues, it's so that our churches are prepared to stand, not to go out and fight these issues in the culture, but so that we're obedient to Jesus. And this is going to be interpreted politically many times. It will be misunderstood. It will be seen as hateful. But it's not. It's preparing people to be faithful disciples of Jesus. Not to. At the same time, I think there's a. Many people are struggling with a tension. Is that when you're a small church like we were in Turkey, we're not focused on challenging the culture. We're focused on discipleship and being faithful to Jesus, and that is its own light, and people are drawn in. Whereas here, the church has been strong, and we're trying to, many people are trying to preserve and not lose the influence that the church has had, not only political influence, but the good influence on society. And so there's a tension, because we have been a strong, large church, and now going into a minority. I don't want to be a culture warrior out fighting, you know, telling people, you know, what the God's standards of morality are. I want that to be in the church. I'm concerned that the church model those, that we be faithful in those areas. I'm not interested in telling my neighbors in Northern Virginia how they should live. I'm interested in the church, for us living the way Jesus wants us to live. But one of the things, as Brad and I have talked about, what are some of the things reasons that pastors could hesitate to talk about these issues? I think many pastors are concerned that if they bring these things up, it's going to divide the church. It will divide their churches, because so many people have different views on these now. And one thing that Brad brought up is that this will make our church seem unloving, that it will make our church seem extreme if we teach on these things. Again, not necessarily confronting the culture with them, but even just in our own church. And I think, yes, it is true. If you teach biblical standards, you are going to be seen as extreme and as unloving. And that's almost unavoidable. You look at Jesus, the most loving man in history, the kindest, most compassionate, gentle. And yet, people said he was demonized. They said he was evil. They ended up killing him. So the important thing is to make sure that when people say that you're unloving and that you are harsh, that it's a slander, that it's not true. Let's make sure that it's a lie. They are going to say it. So you have to prepare yourself for that. But let's make sure that we are gentle and humble in how we conduct ourselves. I do want to read a quote from a man named James Wood, because it talks a little, I think it shows this tension that many of us are living in right now. He says, "To love one's neighbor is to seek their good and goods in common. This bears upon the political, which is focused on our common life and the pursuit of justice. Working to bring about a more just social order is a way to love. We love our neighbors. This will require clarity and conviction. As our culture has increasingly turned away from and become openly hostile to its Christian foundations, and even more basically to conceptions of nature and natural law, such bold positions will be met with fierce opposition. We will be pressured to assume that loving the sinner means affirming and supporting their sin. True love, which calls evil evil and limits violations against the dignity of God's image bearers, will often be experienced as harsh and interpreted as unloving, as unwinsome. We owe it to our neighbors to risk being misunderstood and despised as we seek their good and the welfare of the most vulnerable. We will need courage. A church that is obsessed with appearing winsome will be tempted to over-accommodate the culture's negative propaganda against Christian moral principles, and this will fail our neighbors."
Let me move to just kind of a final question. If you had the people that you know from around the world and they were here sitting in our chairs, and you asked them, how would you help your American brothers and sisters be ready for difficulty or persecution? What might they say? What would be their advice to us?
I think, again, I recommend Andrew's wonderful work and the videos he's made, because there's so much there on preparation for suffering. eternal perspective is part of it. I think it's true that we in America have lived so well that this life has gotten hold of us. It makes it more difficult to make the decision. You know, Hebrews 11 is all about seeing the unseen. Moses, when he became older, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, but chose to suffer reproach with the people of God because he saw the unseen. And we need to gaze steadfastly on the unseen. We need to live out of a diet of realizing that eternity is our destiny, that our destiny doesn't lie in this world. And that is more difficult for us as Americans. And I think some of my friends from around the world have rightly pointed that out to me.
Mm. Great. Other thoughts?
I don't know if that's something we can achieve on this side, but it's very important that we work towards unity and being one in our response towards the persecuted brothers and sisters. It's very easy to think that maybe they caused it on themselves, or maybe they should suffer rightly for that. And perhaps even think that it's because of their sin. One of the things that happened in a village called Bonth, there was a pastor speaking against female genital mutilation, and the women mobilized their husbands against this man and his church. The church was burnt down, and the man was chased out of the village. This is maybe 9 hours away from the city, but once we got the news, I remember one of the church leaders saying, an attack on one is an attack on all of us. Therefore, there was the need for us to come together. Whether it's our response is just prayer at that moment or there was anything we can do, we have to work collaboratively. And I think that that's one area Satan often weakens us when he makes us think that, that kind of situation is happening to that denomination or that local church or that family because they choose to do things differently or they spoke against an issue that they shouldn't have spoken against. As a church, we have to recognize, again, as has been said there, that persecution will come to us. It will come in different ways, but when we hear that one of us is facing it, the best we can do for them is to support them.
We need each other, don't we?
What comes to my mind is one of my relatives last year was deported from China. He was a missionary in South China and was detained for about 24 hours and then given 48 hours to leave with his wife and four kids overnight. And he called it a job change. Okay. And in some of my conversations with him, you know, we've discussed the issue of the church in China and the United States. And the word that I'm recalling from him, from his perspective, is that get more nimble, is the word he said. We tend to be entrenched and inflexible, program-driven, building oriented, a lot of different things. And his words to me were, get nimble, because things are gonna happen and we're gonna need to adjust and we're gonna need to move on the fly in accordance with the Spirit and how God is leading us. But I think that's the word that comes to my mind.
I remember asking one of the pastors that I met would come from China to the secret meeting in Canada, and I said, what would you say to the people of my church if you could come and preach? And he said, oh, that's easy. Guard the word. Now, I want to just ask you a simple question. How many of you have more than three Bibles? How many of you have more than 10 Bibles? Okay, so I have 41. maybe it's his obsession that I collect them, but I don't think about the Bible as something I got to guard. I got, if I lose this one, I get another one. And I can buy it, and I carry this one. So I don't think about it as something that I need to guard, but he saw clearly that the attack comes against the Word of God. And if you will not guard the Word of God, you will not have anything to stand on. Guard the Word. Andrew?
Yeah, I think as Americans, we have a very, you know, we're an immigrant culture, a culture of pioneers. That takes a special kind of drive in people to go to a place they don't know, to start new things, and very entrepreneurial, very a can-do attitude. And God has really used this characteristic in our culture in so many positive ways. One of the ways that doesn't prepare us for hardship is that we always think that we're just going to overcome it and find our way through with no problem. We'll find a way. We're going to learn to suffer. We don't have to learn it ahead of time. You really can't until you actually go through it. But I'm confident that we are going to learn. And what we need to do is have that mentality, begin to prepare our mentality. Suffering is coming. There's an easy way to avoid it in some ways, at least the suffering that comes from persecution, I can compromise. And so it's beginning to develop that mentality that says, there is going to be hardship, there will be suffering, and I'm going to prepare the heart. If you talk to people who come from contexts of persecution, I think of Norine's family, Hungarian father, and just we're the third generation now that has experienced some intense persecution, her grandfather, her father, all of those relatives. And I talked to some of them now, and there's no secret. If you do this, you'll be okay. But there's a preparation of the heart. Preparation of the heart. Preparing yourself mentally to that there will be a cost, and I'm willing to pay it. And you can't really know how costly it will be ahead of time, how difficult it will be. But even accepting that there will be a cost to follow Jesus, increasingly a higher cost to follow him, and saying, I am willing to pay this. I determine I will be faithful to Jesus. The preparation of the heart. We will learn the suffering as we go through it.
So I want to bring us full circle. In this world where we have headwinds and tailwinds, we have opposition and we have opportunity, all of which are taking place. I have had the privilege of having a few Army Rangers as a part of my congregation, and going to the range with them and hanging out with them and learning from them. And what they say is surprise is the enemy. You just don't ever want to be caught off guard. And they use words that I don't really understand, like head on a swivel, you know, eyes in the back of your head, always covering your six. But the key is you don't want to ever be surprised. So the purpose of us taking 5.5 hours to talk about the wave that we see coming is that you aren't surprised. Because when you are surprised, you make bad choices. When you are caught off guard, you react, you don't think. When you are not ready, you don't turn to the Lord and pray, you react in adrenaline, you run or you hide. And our hope is in these videos, again, which are on the EPC website and the study guide, which are free, is that somehow you'll find a way in your church and in your circles just to talk about it. Not to scare people, not to even predict it'll happen in this way at this time, and this is what it'll look like, but simply to say, what do you think about this? And how can we be more ready? How can we prepare our hearts? How can we be closer to the Lord? How can we do those things? One of the studies in the study guide ends with a exposition on a guy by the name of Demas. Many of you know who he is in Scripture. He traveled with Paul on several of his journeys, was called by Paul his fellow worker, is affirmed in a lot of different ways as a co-worker with Paul. And in Paul writes to Timothy, not long before he dies, Demas, who loved the world more, has deserted me. He doesn't tell us why. He doesn't accuse Demas of any great long sin. He just says when push came to shove, as Paul's getting ready to probably be executed, Demas is like, yeah, I think I'm out of here. And I don't want that to be said about me. I don't want that to be said about the teenagers in my church. I don't want that to be said about the people in my oldest classroom of adults. I want people who love the Lord more than they love the world and who endure to the end. And that's really our hope. I want to take just a couple of minutes for us to just pray for our brothers and sisters around the world. And I'll just give each of you a minute to pray, and then I'll close this. So if you just bow your heads and join us, let's just pray for the world where there are more Christians dying today than ever before.
Father, we thank you for the privilege of joining our hearts and our voices now to intercede for those who are suffering around the world, those who are suffering from the sin of others, those who are suffering for the sake of others, to bring them the message of your salvation, those who are suffering for their faith, those who are suffering for their righteousness, those who are suffering for their relationship with you, those who are imitating you in suffering. Lord, you redeemed suffering. You made the cross a beautiful thing. You took suffering and made it the way of salvation. And we pray that all of our brothers and sisters who are suffering today would know your closeness, would know your presence, and even when they don't feel your presence, that you would be with them and sustain them by your grace.
Lord, we think about just how the enemy continues to ravage the church, and that promise that you have given to us as your people, that as the kings of the nations of the earth rage, you who sit on the throne, you laugh. You laugh because you have all of this under your control. And I pray, Lord, that we can be comforted in that truth. You are not taken off guard. Your plans are not thwarted. You are God. So I ask, Lord, that you would remind us, those who are going through persecution right now in different parts of the world, remind them of this truth. And whenever it comes to us, Lord, I pray that you will remind us as well that you have us in the palm of your hand. You care for us, and you will ultimately bring your judgment on the enemy. So I pray that the church will be comforted during those times of persecution. Amen.
Lord Jesus, we pray against the evil one who tries so hard to burden your servants throughout this world, Lord. We pray for the persecuted. We pray for the families of those who have already lost their lives in the service of you and your kingdom. We pray for increased protection as we go into this season, Lord. And we pray for the church in the United States. We pray we would surrender to you, that we would follow you, and that we would guard our hearts and minds and prepare ourselves for what may come.
So I will pray what I have often prayed. I often prayed this for myself in prison, for myself, for my family. Father God, pour out on your sons and daughters the courage, the strength, the confidence and hope, the perseverance, steadfastness of Jesus, that we may run the race set before us and finish well, a beautiful bride purified in the fires of faithful obedience, tested and found worthy of her beloved, of Jesus, the King of glory. So pour out the fullness of your Spirit, the fullness of the Spirit of Jesus on all our brothers and sisters who are suffering for your sake. Strengthen them, and Jesus, shepherd them and take them through. Amen.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we declare that we are under authority. And that, Lord, because of that, we really desire to be more than we are. We desire to be more holy than we are. We desire to be more awake than we are, more merciful than we are, more loving than we are. Lord, we desire to see with your eyes and hear with your ears and serve in the ways that you would have us serve, Lord. So we desire more to be like you. And so we ask right now for our brothers and sisters around the world that same prayer. Would you give them wisdom and discernment and peace and a sense of your presence that is heavy and close? And may things that don't make sense be covered with your sense. And may things that bring turmoil and fear be covered with your peace. And Lord, for all those who today or this week we'll have to stand up and say, Jesus is Lord, at a cost. May they know that they are not forgotten by their brothers far away, by their sisters far away. May they know that they are being prayed for we need each other. What happens to one happens to all. Lord, give us a heart to love the world, to love each other, and to love you more. In Jesus' name, amen.